Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Buddhang dhammang sanghang namasāmi. So the title of this talk is Buddhism, Buddhist practice and environmental concern. And you may have an idea of what your environmental concern is. It's quite easy to get information about the big problems in the ecological sphere. The climate changing and heating up, and concerns about the oceans rising and deserts and water, fresh water disappearing over the next 50 to 100 years. Concern about the loss of animal life, particularly insect life, which is what keeps our plants and our fruit and our flowers growing. Also the poisoning of the water with chemicals and waste material, and of course the poisoning of the air, whereby people find in cities particularly the air quality of the air is poor, and all kinds of complaints and diseases because of that. And then the other thing, if that isn't bad enough, you have the problem of plastic, which is now such a very useful material, but it's also a material that is easily discarded, throw it away, and then it breaks down into the water, and again it gets into the fish, and that comes up the food chain. So we are once again damaging the animal life, but also damaging ourselves through convenience. And much of this ecological destruction is not through hatred by any means, but just through convenience. It's easier this way. It makes life easier. This is the sense we have, and then we begin to look at this and think, well, easier now, but it won't be very easy in 50 years' time, when the city is underwater and the glaciers have disappeared, so they're not getting fresh water in the Mekong or the Ganges or the Yangtze River, and people can't get enough water. And when the soil is so poisoned, we can't grow food on it. It won't be very convenient. So maybe we'll go to Mars. And why it's not convenient is, of course, this is what we all have got used to, and to a large degree, the economy that is geared is directed towards sustaining this convenience. And the economy is based upon being able to take material qualities from the earth, and it's minerals, wood, even concrete. Where does that come from? Dig it up. Sand, using the sand to make buildings. So we can just take material from the earth and use it. And then when we don't, whatever we don't want, we just throw it away back into the earth, where it causes damage. And this is the basis of the economy. It's consumer. You consume and then you spit out what you don't want. And it's really, to put it more bluntly, it's exploitation economy. It's not a circular economy whereby you give and you give back and it recycles. It doesn't do this, it just goes and it goes more. It doesn't recycle. We don't put anything back into the earth. We don't take and then put back. We just take and throw the rubbish back. And this is the basis of the economy, is one of domination and exploitation, with the sense in which the human being is privileged that he or she can take whatever they want from the earth and then throw whatever they don't want into the earth, and the earth has to has to accept that. But we can see that with this number of people doing in this, following this model, however rich and large the earth is, it's not infinite. When 7 billion people are involved one way or another with this kind of model, eventually you have to exhaust the earth, and then what happens then? So economy literally means the management of the house. This is the old Greek word, oikos is house, and onomy means to do with managing it. And there's another word, ecology, which is to do with deep understanding of our house. And what we have now is an economy that doesn't understand the house. The economy and the ecology are in conflict. And so we say we can't stop polluting the earth because it costs too much. It's not convenient. The economy would suffer. And rather than thinking, well, maybe we should try another economy then, because all the investment is in this economy, we run into these big problems. Yeah. So you might agree to that, or at least consider it, and look up the facts and figures that you can find, and what all the scientists are saying. And I think you'll see that, broadly speaking, I'm speaking the truth. But you might also consider, what do I do about it? What's the Buddhist attitude towards this? How does the Buddhist work with this? Yeah. And there are several principles that we try to cultivate, to live in harmony, to be modest, to live with sila, morality, to try to be more careful about what we need, and also to clear our minds of these illusions of convenience and what is for our welfare. But I'd also like you to consider that when I use the word environment, I don't just mean the ecology. So environment means everything that you're involved with or you're connected to. And in this respect, I'd like to suggest that you can look at this in four aspects. One I've just mentioned, which is the material world, the earth and everything material. That we cannot produce anything material ourselves. Human being cannot produce anything material apart from a baby. But even then, you still need food, water, air to keep it going. So we cannot produce material things. Everything material comes from only one place, which is the earth. Yeah? Hmm? So there's this aspect. There's also our individual material, which is this body. We are certainly connected or involved with that. It gives us pain and pleasure. It gives us birth and death. It also is a very important base for meditation. When you train your body, you can find a certain quality of balance that's very, very helpful for calming the mind. We're involved with this. There's also the collective consciousness. This means the ideas, the immaterial phenomena that we're connected to. You could call this religion is an aspect of it, culture is an aspect of it. The ideas and the attitudes, the beliefs that shape us and direct us. Some of these can be just matters of etiquette and custom. Some of them are laws. Yeah, we have laws and order, and we have beliefs, political beliefs, and of course we have religious beliefs. So we're all involved with this to some extent. Otherwise, you know, we cannot be a collective without some immaterial quality that binds people together. Otherwise you'd just be individuals living in the forest. And of course we also have an individual, personal, immaterial world, which is the world of our own mind, which is our joy and fear, our anxiety, our sense of balance, immaterial world. And we cannot get away from this either. All these qualities, these aspects, whether we like it or not, we're involved with them. We are not separate from them. Yeah. Yeah. This is the environment that you should have concern for, all of it. And every aspect is related to every other aspect. So we can see, for example, when greed takes over the mind, then other creatures will suffer because we're greedy, we take more than we need. So you see a very simple example of when an immaterial phenomenon, a thought, a desire arises, it's going to affect the physical world around us. And of course it will affect our culture as well. And what becomes clear is it even affects your own body. Because a greedy person is restless and they're not comfortable. Their minds never settle in their bodies. They're always stressed. Yeah. And we begin to see the results of consumer economy and exploitation economy. It begins to exploit human beings also, whereby people are entering into work situations whereby they are extremely stressed, stressed to the point when they are losing harmony with themselves. And this is quite normal. Quite normal. Somebody said I teach in all these different places in the world, in Europe, America, Australia, Africa also, and Asia, everywhere, same people. Just got different faces. Stress. Stress. Anxiety. Yeah. Worry. Problem. Yeah. Not in living in harmony, looking around, feeling the world is something they can't manage. They have to struggle to get by. And they're struggling to get by basically in a world that human beings have created. They're not struggling for water, they're struggling to get money. They're struggling to survive in a situation that's been created by fellow human beings. Why? Why did we create something like this? And you think, well, then you look and you realize, that's very interesting. It says here that half of the wealth in the world is controlled by 30 people. 30, maybe some people say 50, some people say 20, but half of the wealth on the earth is controlled by average 50 people. That's the economy. And you can study this yourself if you like. You know, the richest people in the world, $100 billion, or I don't know, $50 billion. You cannot spend that amount of money. It's just other people, you know, starving. So it never been so unequal. That's the economy. And so that's the model that's created this particular situation. And it's not that the person who has $50 billion has worked 50,000 times harder than anybody else. He just put the money in investment, banking, he knew how to exploit and use the system to earn more money. It wasn't because he worked harder, he just used the system. Yeah. This is greed. And distorted perception. So we can see then that I suggest that this situation that we find ourselves in is generated primarily through human ignorance. And the situation doesn't just affect elephants, fish, yeah. It affects society. Society, because if you have inequality in the society, then you get poor people, very rich people, then you have to have crime, violence. When you get a lot of rich people, you get corruption, yeah, exploitation, and so forth. And it affects, then it affects the culture, the society, social model, which although we may be, you know, this person is Islam, this person is Christian, basically the dominant force is materialism, is the basic religion of humanity. If you look at it, the thing that really drives people, you know, you've got the temple and you've got the bank, which is more important. You know, it's the money. And then if you've got time, you maybe go to the temple. And so this supremacy of the materialism, it affects the mind, it affects the culture, it affects the planet, and it even affects the human body. In that the people consider the human body to be the thing we see with our eyes, and so there's a lot of attention given to the outward appearance of it. the human body becomes a kind of commodity. Right? Fashion, cosmetics, beautification, diet, make the human body look as good as possible. This is a billion-dollar industry. Right? And which you can start believing in this idea of the beautiful human body from the age of 2 or 3, and you'll spend lots of time and lots of worry and anxiety about making the human body something that fits the model on the advertisement, the model in the magazine. It's a man or a woman, men generally a bit of muscle, yeah, nice shape, women, nice shape, hair. You don't see them with wrinkles, broken teeth, grey hair, they're all... And actually, many of these people that you see on the magazine don't actually exist. They take the photograph and they adjust it. Take a line off, it's too fat, just trim that down, take that wrinkle out, paint it, look, much better. Yeah. And then you've got to look like that. Because of money. So people go and buy stuff. So that's the human body. And the Buddha was very clear. He said, this is either not something to get interested in. In fact, if we're really true about the human body, it's kind of like this, you know. And if you take the skin off, it's really not something you want to go dancing with. But also, even more significant, something that's almost completely lost, the understanding, you say, within this body, and this is a saying, within this very body is the arising of the world, the beginning of the world, the path, the way leading out of the world, the deathless is found in this body. Oh, what do you think? I can't find it. Where is that? And what he's referring to is not the coarse material form, but the subtle energy in the body, the life force, pana or prana, Indian word prana, Sanskrit, Pali word pana. So when you see the topic of mindfulness of breathing is called anapanasati, which refers to this circulation of energy that occurs within the body, which moderates the mind, and which can get very subtle and refined to the point when the physical aspects of the body are no longer manifesting in your consciousness. You move into the fine material realm. And you say, well, this is a really important aspect to understand. And most people have no idea what that is. Yeah. It's lost. With all the skills that are available, you know, people, you cultivate this, you don't need to eat so much. You stay healthy, you still live long, you stay bright and alive. So this, of course, now is just the domain of a few monks or shamans or, you know, qigong experts who do things we just think are amazing, because it's now so rare. We've lost that. Instead, we have a body that you put clothes on and you colour and you... Because that brings money in. Yeah, and people feel it will make them more acceptable to other people. And you think, you know, like, what are we here for? Just to look at each other's skin? Is that the most important aspect of a person? The shape of their cheek? Or what's that got to do with anything, really? You know, you really, what you want to find in another human being is something you can trust, something you feel safe with, something you feel is wise and loving. That's what you want. You don't want hair. So this aspect of our environment is also something that's taken over by this materialism. Now, this four aspects represent what the Buddha called the world or the cosmos. I use the word cosmos because it means I'm not talking about the political world or the financial world or even the planet Earth. I'm talking about the world which is our total environment. It means the ecology, the body, the society, the social understanding, and our own mind. So this is what we're involved with. This is the cosmos. Call it that word. And he said, this actually, Dhamma is the law or the principle that keeps the cosmos in harmony. Dharma is a very difficult word to find a single English word for. But it means something like a law, or a principle, or an order that encompasses everything and keeps it in harmony. This is the Dhamma. And the Buddha teaching is a Dhamma that brings us into harmony. It itself is a harmonious law involving eight aspects. You know, so all the Buddha's teachings fit together to find harmony and balance. The very principle of right view is the sense of connection to moral qualities, connection to other people, and connection to sages and seers. Yeah, so it's karma and virtue, and it's something that covers everything. And so this dharma is the sense of the law or the order that keeps everything in harmony. And of course, one of the central principles of Dhamma is sila, is morality. It's the ethical balance. And it's said in the suttas, when people lose morality, then the devas, the spiritual forces, are not happy. The weather starts to go strange, the rain doesn't come, the seasons go lopsided, go out of joint, the crops start to fade out, and famine begins. This is because of the lack of sila. And he says, when kings and ministers are not righteous, then everybody down, from down the king on down, becomes unrighteous. Therefore, the planet is damaged, and people starve, and there's brutality and violence. And he says this, the central principle of sila. So this is definitely a Buddhist concern. And when we really begin to consider this, this means, you know, we have to broaden our perspective. Sila hiriyotapa. Hiriyotapa means a sense of conscience for other creatures. Because we feel ashamed of ourselves if our mind is taken over by hatred or greed, we feel we've stained ourselves. And we also feel we've lost the respect of others. So it's a kind of respect system. We respect ourselves and we respect others. And the true cultivation of that hiriyotapa is to extend it beyond your immediate family to other human beings, and then beyond human beings to animals and to life form itself. So it extends. Yeah. Then the wider that sense of hiriyotapa, of sila dhamma, extends, then the richer and deeper the harmony is. So, and now we are such a dominant force on the planet. The imperative for all of us is that we develop, train, refine, and extend our sense of sila. For example, you know, when the Buddha and the monks were staying in, they've been invited to a town to spend the rains retreat. During the vassa, the rains retreat, as you know, the Sangha has to stay where they are. They can't go. They have to stay where they are. And during this rains retreat, the food ran out. There wasn't any food. There was a famine. So the monks, you know, were starving, hungry. And Mahamoggallana, one of the great disciples, he said, "I know under the earth there's this kind of substance you can dig up that we could live on. I could turn it over with my hand, and there's this rich humus under the ground that would sustain human beings." And Buddha said, "Don't do that, because the animals, the insects would be disturbed. You would confuse and disturb them. We'll starve." And then when a monk made a hut, he used mud from the river to make a hut, the Buddha said, "You have to destroy that, because when you dug that mud up, you damaged the lives of the insects that lived in the mud." So the Buddha wouldn't allow trees to be cut down. And he talked about, you know, the harm of taking life. Say when you go to take a cow or a pig and you want to eat it, just when you approach it with that intention in your mind, you already commit, demerit, evil. When you grab hold of it and you pull it, that's another time. And each of these occasions, you commit deep, grievous harm to yourself. And then when the creature struggles and you keep pulling it, and it fights and you keep pulling it, and then you take a knife and kill it, he said, these are five occasions when you commit deep evil. Clearly, he was pretty consistent in his attitude toward fellow creatures. So that even if you build a kuti, you have to make sure it's nowhere near an ant nest in case the ants are disturbed. You don't want to disturb them. You have to live in harmony. So this is an example of the kind of attention we need to cultivate. Now, of course, most of us nowadays, we don't take knives and kill crew, we just go to the supermarket. Somebody else does it. So we don't really see that we're supporting this kind of activity, where animals by the thousand. I think 53 billion in 2010, 53 billion animals were killed so that we could eat them. And you see, if you look into intensive farming and you see the animals are treated, you wouldn't want to see it. And yet we don't see it because we just go to the shop, Kentucky Fried Chicken, great, you know. You don't see it, so you don't know. So the other aspect we have to really develop, because, we're not actually doing it, but we're supporting, by our money, we're supporting an activity that does this to creatures. What can I do? Well, I can train my mind to clear this short-sightedness. So another fundamental quality the Buddha recognized, it's so commonly expounded in the scriptures, is The Pali word is yoniso manasikara, which means there's something like deep or systematic or careful attention. Well, you don't just look at something, you look at something and think, where does that come from? Where does it go? What's it about? Yeah? What's it about? What actually is the meaning or the significance of this thing? So this is a deep attention. Superficial attention is just gone. Yeah? So with deep attention, we may say, look at something and think, well, where did this come from? Well, it came from the earth. Right. What did it take to bring it here? We had to dig it up. Dig it up, burn it, melt it, produce it, and then where does it go to? We just... we call it throw it away. We throw it away. Where's away? Where is this place called away? it's not away. It's in your earth. It's in your water. It's in your air. It's in, you're going to come back into your body or your children. There's no such place as away. So with deep attention, you begin to look at this and think, what do I buy? What do I consume? What do I throw away? Can I buy less? Can I consume less? Can I recycle or be appropriate in what I make use of? Careful attention. You know, attend carefully. And you start to realize there are certain fundamental and really very significant cultural, you could say, principles that the Buddha expounded, which are not peculiar to Buddhism. They're not esoteric. They are the principles that will keep any group in harmony. If we have to have a collective experience as human beings, because we cannot live individually, we have to live part of a group, to the three qualities that we should cultivate. Generosity, dana, which means the enjoyment and the eagerness to share. I like sharing. It brings friendship. It gives warmth. And many cultures before the industrial culture would make a very strong attempt that every year they would go and just give things to their fellow beings, you know, or fellow humans. They'd even, you know, travel across the ocean to visit other islands. Just this sense of circling so that the wealth and the goodwill and the sense of sharing was kept things in harmony. And there's one, when you look at some of the ways and means, the skills of pre-industrial people, they would always do things like this. You go somewhere, you have to make gifts. You have to share. You have to make a point of it. They say, a poor person is a disgrace to the village. It means we have not looked after them. It's a shame upon us if someone is allowed to be poor. We should share. Yeah, we should share. Otherwise, we're lost. We're lonely, and we're not being proper humans. When we consider this and extend this principle, we think, well, maybe I could share also with other creatures, like give them a place where they could live. You know, I don't want to live with a crocodile, but he could live over there, that's fine. You know, we try to create places where other creatures could live, and just out of mutual respect. We're not the only creature on the planet. And you could even say, from the planet's point of view, we're not that important. Actually, a worm is more important than we are. Or a bee is more important than we are. So couldn't we you know, give them something instead of poisoning them. Dana, sila, the second great principle. And you're more likely to have morality when you have a sense of, you know, there is sharing, because we really see each other as fellow human beings. There's no jealousy, there's no sense of resentment, no competition. And the last principle is called nekama, renunciation, to put aside what you don't need and to really look into being as, and to develop this so that we keep revising, what do I really need? Yeah. And be quite clear to avoid the consumer disease, where purchasing things is a form of entertainment. If you've got nothing else to do, go shopping. And you buy what? It's stuff, you know. So these principles, and then of course, this is the way that monasteries operate, where you can live, for example, in my monastery, which is not unusual. You may have, I don't know, any time, maybe 30 people living there, one washing machine, one car. Always guests, always welcome, always food, yeah, share. It makes life so much easier. You know, you share a room, you share your house, you try to live in as modest a place as possible, to take as least of the planet as possible, just to eat what is necessary to keep going. And this is basic monastic principle. And we think, oh, that's for monks. No, not really. Just monks have rules about it. Because you have to train in it. But it's certainly an encouragement for all of us, particularly at this time when so much is being consumed, till there's not anything left. And nothing, what are your grandchildren going to live on if you've eaten it all up? Yeah, so these are important things to cultivate and develop. And when we cultivate like this, we begin to sense, most importantly, well, the planet will benefit. Other human beings will feel a sense of trust and respect because they will not harm us, they will not lie to us, they will not abuse us, they will not make sexual misconduct with us, because we trust them, therefore we're happy to share with them. You can share my house because I know you're not going to steal anything. So each principle supports the other. No sila, you can't, how can you share with people you can't trust? And so this is very much the situation we have now, whereby because of the low level of sila, people can't, violence, people can't trust each other. So a lot of defense, security, law, police. And you think, this is so normal. But even in the time of the Buddha, there were no police. The human beings lived together, and many, you know, earlier civilizations, there was no police force. There was just a sense of hiriotapa. And if you didn't behave properly, then the elders would look at you with a sense of, you're not really well, you know, you're not one of us. And the shame would correct you. Yeah. There are no prisons. No, yeah. And we take these things for granted as necessary because we've lost personal responsibility for sila and collective responsibility for sila. So sila has to be kept by the police because we can't keep it ourselves. But then even the police don't keep it all because it's corruption. So where does it begin, you know? It has to start here, doesn't it? And not from fear, fear of getting punished, but this makes me feel better and it makes me enjoy other people better and I feel more relaxed and happy and comfortable. And because of this, my mind is at peace. Yeah. So it always comes back to the thing you can test is at the end of the day, through all the practices you do, the way you're living, is your mind getting more peaceful? That's the peace you cannot run away from. That's the incontrovertible truth. Yeah, so meditation, again, is a very significant aspect of our environmental concern. If I don't meditate, I'm liable to be caught in delusion, in ignorance, in fear and mistrust. I'm liable to lose that sense of metta, karuna. Therefore, this must be cultivated and developed. And the attitudes of it need to be developed so that our meditation continually informs our sense of relationship, our sense of friendship, even our sense of security. And of course, you know, as now Somdet Buddhaghosa Jan, he was always calls himself Bhikkhu Paiuto, because his name keeps changing. But way back in the 1990s, he said, you know, the three fundamental misperceptions that human beings have is, first of all, they think they're separate from the rest of nature. And you can do, no, that's not true. They think they're separate from other beings, other humans. And that's not true. Yeah. And if we believe that our happiness and security will come from following materialism, and that's not true. So when you turn it around, you say, what is true? This is, of course, the heart of Buddhism. It starts here. Are you peaceful? Is your life rich? Do you feel burdened? Something going wrong here. What do you develop? And it starts here, but it continues out there. And this is the way our practice and concern has to develop. From here, out there. And from out there, back to here. This is metta karuna, mindfulness and Dhamma practice for our welfare and the welfare of others. So I offer this for your consideration this evening. Thank you.
Now it's the Q&A session. If there is anyone want to ask questions.
Thank you, Ajahn, for the enlightening talk. In many parts of the world, there are a lot of violence, as you've mentioned. I happen to come from Hong Kong, which has a lot of violence, as well as people lacking certain level of sila. For a practitioner like myself, being entangled in what's happening in the place that I live in, what advice do you have for someone like me who lives in a very a city that's full of conflict? Thank you.
What advice do I have for people living in Hong Kong?
or people living in a place where there's a lot of conflict in the society. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, you know, the basis of is good people, to associate with good people. And to so that's the most important thing for anywhere. And what is a good person? So they're keeping the precepts, at least the five precepts, and that's what you associate with. And you realize that although we have passports that say we belong to Britain or America or Thailand, we don't. We don't belong to these places. We belong to the Dhamma. We belong to the Dhamma world, and you know, we have to recognize that our nations throughout history have always gone into these cycles of violence and collapse, even, you know, and that's not a comfortable or agreeable phenomenon to experience. But it's important for us to remember our refuge and our basis, and to stay firm with that. I don't, as you can imagine, I don't have a political solution. But the more that you know, violence, however, it creates more violence. So it's like a fire. There's no usefulness in any kind of violent protest. It always has to be non-violent. The only movements that succeed really are non-violent, because those are the only movements in which people can change their view. If you violently oppose someone, it won't change their view. They'll become firmer in it. But if you, you know, try to bring across the truth in a peaceful manner, it takes a long time, but that's the way that you can actually bring around social change as best you can. Yeah, we can see even in the time of the Buddha, even with the Buddha around, there was wars, fighting, battles going on, countries destroying other countries. It's the way the world is, I'm afraid.
Questions?
Thank you so much for your teaching this evening. I wanted to ask, in the process of trying to incorporate some of the values into my life, stemming from an understanding of our relationship with the natural world that you've been talking about this evening, at times I've noticed in my mind, like if I'm trying to live by certain values, I've also noticed things such as judgment and pride arise. And these are a different kind of poison than the environmental ones you've been speaking about. And sometimes when I notice these like mental poisons arise, it can make me revert back to previous behavior or to shy away from, to not necessarily know how to live in accordance with these views, and also maintain upekkha. So I wanted to ask if you have any advice for how to be able to change our habits and our mind and to be more conscious of the things that you are speaking of this evening without also avoiding such things as, for example, pride and judgment and separateness.
That's all, no? Well, yeah, it's really understanding nature of thought and views is very important. Probably in the Buddhist teaching, more than any other teaching, there's a strong understanding of the power of views and the danger and the seduction of views, because they seem right. And there's a lot of suffering in being right. There's suffering in being wrong, and there's suffering in being right. So someone who understands this doesn't believe too ultimately in right and wrong. And they understand also what happens in the mind when we feel right. There's a certain passion and a certain upadana, clinging to this view. And then once we cling to this view, I become my view and you are something different. And then there's no way you can avoid conflict. So, you know, this is the process of what's called papancha, which means from this craving, a certain passion for a position, you know, gives rise to a conceit, which gives rise to a point of view. So once we feel, you know, this is true, this is right, then you feel your energy going into that particular perspective and viewpoint, and then you become hard with it, and then you start to judge everybody else from that. And so this always creates opposition. And in our practice, this is why the practice of harmony is so crucial and so subtle. Yeah. It's crucial, it's subtle, it means that you avoid that, and you see it as dangerous. And instead, you replace that with qualities of metta, karuna, mudita, upeka, with qualities of respect, with qualities of truthfulness and honesty, so that what you bring across is just an offering in truth of how you see things. And if that is the most convincing offering. You know, if it has no pressure to it, it's much more easy for people to take it in. In fact, it becomes almost irresistible. It's strange that the harder we push, the more resistance we will experience. The less push there is, the less you say, well, it's up to you. You know, I respect you and I you know, I'm concerned for your welfare, but, you know, it seems to me that when my mind does this, I feel this, you know. And because you realize certain qualities that we're capable of lead to our own distress. And if you see that another person, in a way, it's your duty to tell them. Not because you're trying to change them, but just because that's your duty. And that's offered. So Buddha always said you have to offer any kind of advice or counsel always with the mind of concern for the other person's welfare. Not, you should be like this, and you shouldn't do that. That will most immediately resistance. Whereas if it's more like, I wonder, since you're a person, you know, who I respect for, if, when you act in this way, what do you find the results are? Because they probably don't even notice. You know, we realize the common problem we have is we live in this and we see this. We can only see this. But we live in this. How do you know what your back of your head looks like? You had somebody else to tell you. And if you don't realize it, or you don't think it's important, then somebody has to say why it is important. This is what karma's about. You know, it means everything we do, anything anybody does, any inclination their mind has, will always give rise to a result that they will have to experience. And sometimes that's really quite horrifying to see that the way people act, they'll have to experience the results of that. And they just feel a sense of deep sadness and shock at the hell realms people are creating for themselves. And also, of course, the pain that we can create for each other through ignorance. Which is in a way, again, you know, why we, in many respects, we have very advanced, progressive societies, everything's, we go fast, we can travel all over the place, we've got amazing things. Why aren't we happy? We're happy sometimes, but it's not that we have no intelligence, we have profound intelligence, extreme refined intelligence. It's not that we don't have love. People can do magnificent things, yeah? And there are many magnificent things being done. But people just suffer from this delusion, this kind of narrow closure, and seduced by pleasure, by short-term pleasure, and seduced by the sense of being right, the supremacist model. You know, we're the most important creature on the planet, human beings, most important creature. Of all the people, you know, this group or this kind of society is the most important. And people, this is the supremacist model, and it means that what's happening in the human societies is the diversity is dwindling. Everybody's buying into the global model, consumer model. And people of the land, in the Amazon, they're all dying out. Their land is being taken away from them. So the languages, of which there were many thousands, are dying out. Diversity is dying out. Cultural difference is dying out. There's just many shades of the same kind of global model. If you go down the highway in Bangkok, you could be in Los Angeles, you could be in Tokyo. It's much the same. Fast food, you know, it's the same. You know, where's the diversity gone? Because we've all got hypnotized into this model. And there's a collective karma in that. So it's not that you want to actually get everybody to be the same, but for people to really understand that their actions count. Again, this is another significant feature that we have to comprehend, is because we do live in a global society of telecommunications. We can witness what's happening in Iran or Syria or anywhere else, and you just feel, helpless. And this deprives a human being of their potency, their potential. I can't do something about Syria, but I can do something about purifying my mind, speaking truth, and acting right now in a way that's respectful. And if I do that, maybe she'll do it and he'll do it, and maybe that will grow, because this makes us happier. That's what we can do. And we should never lose that faith in human nature. So it's important that even when we have to see the shortcomings in others, we still maintain that respect and faith in their basic human quality. And you don't want somebody to be like me. You want them to be truthful as they are. And, you know, this is very important, I think.
Thank you.
We still have time for the last question.
In this world, we may still have to use money. How can we use it wisely, or how can we treat it? Thank you.
How to use money? Money can establish, or can be used to establish, generosity and sharing and fairness. Yeah. So that you can use it to distribute wealth and fairness to other people. When it's not useful, what it's not useful is hoarding it. When it just sits and sits there getting bigger, it becomes like a cancer. You know, dead money is dangerous. Yeah. So one wants to use one's wealth or financial to build helpful trading relationships that are fair and help to distribute wealth. Wealth and money are two different things, really, although they're often linked together. When you consider it, there's nothing of less value than money. You can't drink it, you can't eat it, you can't wear it, you can't shelter under it. It's useless, it's just a number. It's the most useless thing in the world. It's purely a token of promise, but it's a promise that's never kept. Money is just a way of moving a debt around. And most of the money that is used has no backing apart from financial trading, apart from currency. There's nothing underneath it. It's not related to gold, nothing real. It's just cloud money. Yeah? And so, but if you let it sit and store, it gets bigger and bigger, and then it destroys people's minds. It destroys their ethical sense. It destroys their sense of sharing and equality. You know, if you have, you know, $50 billion, is something wrong with you. You shouldn't. You know, you have that propensity, you should be sharing like crazy. You don't want to have it. You want to make sure it moves around. Money that moves around is okay. It's when it sits still, it becomes cancerous. I don't think you have a problem with having too much. But if you move it around, it stays healthy. If you move it in the right directions, you can do good things with it. And so it's a power. It's funny because of the two most powerful influences in our lives is money and the sense of self, and neither of them exist. They're the most powerful forces that control us, yeah? And they're something we need to break out of. Money is a form of connection, yeah? Human beings should connect to each other, they should not stand apart as separate entities in that respect. And that's the way you try to use it. How can this be a benefit to this person? The Buddha gave quite a lot of advice to businessmen about make sure that you give a portion away so that it doesn't take over your mind. And I think if you have money, I think you can use it to say, well, I'll spend a little more of this on a business that's ethical, even if it costs a little bit more, because I believe in the ethics, not the number. If it's going an ethical way, I'll support that rather than what's cheapest or most convenient. And then it's useful. You can affect the market. And it's one of the great powers that lay people have. When we see that the economy has such a powerful effect on the society and on the planet, on human beings' minds, you know, every one of you with money can in some way steer that. You can say, I'm not buying that. I'm not buying that. I'm not buying that. I'll put my money there. That's the way you can turn things around, you know. Yeah. That's the way you turn things around, by refusing to put your money into something that you don't feel ethically clear about. And then that's useful.